Ladies and gentlemen, my name is LaMarcia McKellen. I'm here with my cohorts, Mrs.
Carmen Young,
Chelsea Strong,
Rachel Gordon,
and we are with EDM 310, and we're here to talk to you about Raithe Swift and lighting their fires. First, I'm going to give you a little information about Raithe Swift. He's an innovative, multiple award-winning American teacher at Hobart Boulevard Elementary School in Los Angeles, California. Many of his students, who are all from communities of poor and immigrant families, start class very early, leave late, and typically achieve the high scores in standardized testing. His teaching honors include the 1992 Disney National Outstanding Teacher of the Year Award, a Sigma Beta Delta Fellowship from Johns Hopkins University, and Oprah Winfrey's 100,000 Use Your Life Award. Mr. Swift's fifth grade students constantly score in the top 5 to 10% of the country in standardized testing. So, ladies and gentlemen, this man knows what he's doing. First thing we're going to do is jump off into our books. Pre-game show is what we're talking about. And the first thing we're arguing is a quote in the book says, these students weren't born extraordinary. They became that way. And Ms. Rachel, how do you feel about this quote that Mr. Swift?
I disagree. I think that every child is born extraordinary. And I think it takes work on both, you know, parents and teachers who influence the children to make sure that they remain extraordinary. But I think that every child is born extraordinary with extraordinary abilities.
Okay, anybody else got anything they want to input on that?
I agree with that. As long as they're getting it from the teachers and the parents, then they'll remain that way.
All right, so we'll let you come to tell you that every student, every child is extraordinary. Moving on to the second point, let's see. Children are born with varying levels of talent and intelligence, but possessing natural smarts and skills is no guarantee of success. Anybody want to speak on that real quick?
I think that, you know, children are born with different levels of talents and intelligence. Everybody's unique, and they have different qualities that they bring. I think that, you know, I think they do possess natural smarts. I don't think that that's, you know, that they actually know how to use them. I think that we need to, you know, teach them how to use what they have.
All right, and the fact that you said that leads us straight into our next point. It says it takes more than that. It takes work on the part of the parent and the teachers to cultivate these qualities. How do you think about that, Ms. Strongfield?
I totally agree. The teachers have them most of the day and most of the year, so in order for them to learn, and it has to be a parent's job and a teacher's job to keep it going throughout their life.
Most definitely. Third thing in pregame show, we really enjoyed this part of the book. Children are capable of learning astonishing things in the most unexpected places. All right, I really agreed on these things because, you know what, being a football player and a baseball player, I learned more than just the game when I was on the field, when I was on the court, when I was on the field, when I was in the diamond, you know, baseball diamond. But, while I was on the field, I learned more than just how to catch, how to throw, how to hit, how to be angry and focus that anger. I learned respect from my coaches, respect from my teammates. I learned how, you know, when someone is listening, when someone is talking, like, it's best for you to listen. It's, you get more things in the most unexpected places. And I really agree with what he said about this part of the book.
That's just like an art. You know, they try to, what's that word, interrogate, like, science with your artwork. Mm-hmm. So that'll help, like, the students that don't know with the plant, little petals and all that is, they can learn it in another way.
Right. It's the pregame show, ladies and gentlemen. The second thing we were supposed to read by Mr. Swift was the eighth ending, and I'm telling you, it's about to get a little heated in here. The first point of the eighth ending we want to talk about is degrading societal values. And poverty have created school environments where kids are increasingly rude and apathetic. I'm sure everybody wants to say something on this. Whoever wants to hit it, you can hit it first.
I absolutely agree with that. I think that in the different schools, you've gotten, you know, teachers that just don't care because they think, you know, okay, well, this is a low poverty school. They have parents at home that they may care, but they don't, you know, have the time to be there. Like Chelsea said before, they're, you know, the majority of their time is spent at the school. And when you get teachers that have given up on these students, then you end up with a group of very rude and apathetic children.
Teachers think sometimes that it's just babysitting them. And then they go home. That's where they learn everything at home, when in reality, you need to learn from school, too, and at home.
Well, Well, you know, I do agree with you guys, and I'm going to read this again. It says degrading social values and poverty have created school environments where kids are increasingly rude and apathetic. Now, when you go to the school system and you're in the school and you got the kids running around acting like they're crazy, first and foremost, I understand that you're there to teach the students. Teachers have a lesson plan. It's not the teacher's sole responsibility to teach a kid how not to be rude. If they're not getting it when they're at home, if they're not being told, you know, shut up when I'm talking, or, you know, listen, sit down, be quiet. If they're not getting that, you can't expect, a teacher can't be a teacher and a parent. That's what I'm trying to say.
Well, teachers, that's true, too, but if you lay down those guidelines, when you walk in my door, I don't care what you do at home or you do in somebody else's class, when you walk through my door, these are my rules, and this is what you're going to follow. And when they get out in the real world, they can take that with them and say, oh, well, you know, Mr. McKellar was like, these are the rules that you're going to follow. You're going to be respectful. You're going to, you know, follow my rules whether you like them or not. Then they can apply that in real life.
And in some situations, like, the students look up to the teachers and the basketball coaches and the football coaches that are like their parents. Second parent, I should say.
I think that most kids, they respect authority, even though, you know, they want to deny that they respect authority. But I think there's a fine line there that, you know, they're going to try to rebel because that's in their nature. But I think that they really do respect that authority. And if you set those rules and you make them follow them.
And start young.
Right.
Not start at 16 when they're already almost grown.
Right.
You know.
All right. As you can see, we had a lot to say about that. Charter schools. This is another point that Mr. Smith made in his book here, Charter Schools, asking you to voluntarily select them as a place that will give your child the best education possible. Now, I know that, especially in my home, my mom always pushed education. Mm-hmm. Always pushed education for myself. But right here, he's talking about, as parents, we need to choose and decide whether this school is a good school, not just because, oh my gosh, their ACT scores are through the roof, or, oh my gosh, you're feeding my kid a good lunch. Because I know I was always concerned about lunch. But anybody else, anybody want to say anything about this?
I think you kind of summed it all up.
Oh, my.
I mean, I agree with you. And I think, you know, one thing that he's saying is, you know, make sure that, you know, you check the school out. Don't just go based off of, you know, because the school.
If my best friend goes there, or your best friend's teacher, or what you heard or something, actually go in there, you know, read the fine print and
do
see what it's all about.
Right. Don't take their word for it that they're going to give your child the best education. It's up to the parent. And just because it is a charter school doesn't mean that they're going to get a better education there than they would in a public school.
And you know what? That can move us to another point we have here. And it says, don't shield children from unpleasantness. Use it as an example of what's wrong with the world to show them how to make things right. Anybody want to hit on that? I really agree with this topic, but you know, I'm talking a lot here.
I agree with that too. And like in his example in the book was, you know, he's at the baseball field and he's got, you know, other people coming down, they've been drinking, and, you know, a lot of people would say, well, you know, I'm not taking my child there. But don't shield them from the people that do wrong, but use that as an example as to, you know, this is
what you don't do as a lesson.
As a lesson.
Yes. This is what you don't do, and this is what you do. Like, set boundaries.
You know, I know the last time we were here and we were talking, we really enjoyed this thing here. It says, the best schools are at their best every day, not just when they know guests are observing. And I remember when I had something to say about that because in my classroom, the teacher would be, he's like, you know what? Somebody's coming tomorrow. If y'all be good, be quiet.
Get some candy.
Get some candy. We'll have a party. We'll do something to show you that, you know, just be good. Just be good. So, and I really agree with the fact. Surprising. You got to surprise your kids. Not only surprise your kids, but surprise the teachers. Everything doesn't have to be announced these days. I mean, I understand that, you know, like it said, kids are rude and stuff, and so are the people. You walk up in somebody's classroom unannounced, you might get a little something that you really weren't expecting.
That's what you really want to see, though. You really want to see people in their actual habitat. You don't want to see something that's
robots.
Like, yeah, you don't want to see robots. You want to see the real thing.